What I would like now, for the final kind of exercise we're going to have in the semester, is a volunteer, you. Come on up. Have a seat. The couple being taped?
Sure.
Tell the folks, tell the camera who you are.
I'm Christina Jenkins. I am a social worker with Hospice and Palliative Care in Mitchell County, North Carolina. I've been there for an extended period of time, and I am finishing up with the master's program. Hooray.
What's your role at the agency?
Currently, my role within the agency is shifting, and with the shift there has been a lot of, for lack of a better word, commotion. So a lot of the commotion and a lot of the unsettled rest and a lot of the factors that you discussed tonight have to do with a lot of changes in policy, procedure, personnel. It's all encompassing. Basically, people are doing more work for less pay with far greater expectations, which does not make for a good situation. And unfortunately, when we put in a bureaucracy, that's what can happen sometimes. So as of June 1, my role as a social worker, which is kind of sad, will shift to a human service organizational manager. Totally. Total shift. 360. Covered tonight is one of those roles where you shift out of what you're good at and what you feel drawn to into something that you hope you feel just as drawn to and just as passionate.
Are you getting some idea why you're the one who volunteered for this?
Yeah.
Okay, I want, if you would, and again, this is being taped, so it's only within the limits of what your level of comfort happened to be. Will you talk about what it's meant for you to move, as you're anticipating moving from the practitioner level to the manager level?
Practitioner level, there was much more, I think, concreteness because I went into work, I knew my job role, my job expectations. There were other social workers, there were other clinicians, there was a care plan team. And it's almost that I'm off of that team, and I'm moved into another role, which does not have the cushion of that team around it. I have the support of the staff, yes. I have a quality staff. Let's say I have. I will be working, serving a quality staff, and hopefully serving them well. But there was a major dynamic shift, and even though I haven't stepped into, transitioned into that role, I can already feel the shift and the change in the way people perceive and view me.
Were you going into some detail about that?
Working with other social workers closely, sharing a very limited office space and communicating with them about business as well as life in general, you cannot help but develop some kind of bond with people, nurses, social workers, clinical staff, because we're in the vehicle, we do home visits, we spend our day together, so you're not going to talk about clinical stuff 24/7 while you're on the job, you want to share life. And one of the biggest, maybe I don't want to say what could be or could not be one of the biggest hindrances is these people know a lot about me to a degree. I don't have people in the office that I go out on the weekend with, but I have people in the office who know me. So there are people in the office who are concerned that I may share a closer relationship because I have spent more time with some people on the job, not off the job. So there is concerns that I can see surfacing by just body language and the undercurrent of the office as to how some people will employ their ability to sway me in certain areas and or not.
Have you begun to sense people's relationships with you changing?
Yes, good and bad. people are a little bit more mindful of what they say to me and how they say it already. But I have been more mindful of how I present myself to them and the role transition because of the great amount of unsureness, because in the past year in the organization I'm in, there has been so much. It's just as if you took a snow globe and just took all the parts loose in the snow globe, warm the snow, turn it up, shake it up, and then set it back down, and just the parts fall where they may. So there is a lot of apprehension and a lot of unsureness that they verbalize to me. One of the things they feel confident in is the transition in the leadership roles of work. That when you have a new person shifting into that role, it's still very scary. Mm-hmm. It would be scary for me, you know.
Mm-hmm. As a boss that's been there for, the boss lady's been there for 15 years, and she has been excellent, but I am not her. And that's something that that I'm already trying to lay the groundwork for. We are the same, but we are equally very, very different. She was also a social worker who transitioned into the role as manager.
Have you had the experience yet of, let's say, checking, deciding that you wouldn't say something to somebody that you would have had you not been making this transition to a new role?
Absolutely. The words that I used, there was no reason for them to ever use words against me, not saying that they would, but I must be careful in my word selection because you don't really know how it's going to be interpreted, and how they filtered it, what they walked away with, so I choose my words more wisely because, you know, I don't want to hear them again circled all the way around a very different meaning, It can happen very quickly.
Mm-hmm. What are the feelings that you've experienced? And again, this is just within the level of your comfort in sharing these things, but what are the feelings that you've experienced when you've realized that it's important to check what you were going to say, that no longer say things or to say things to people that you would have been quite comfortable in doing in the past?
It's twofold. It has good. I try to look at it twofold, good and bad. It makes me more mindful to bridle my tongue sometimes that maybe I was talking a little bit too much before about things that I didn't need to be discussing. But it just makes me, not in a negative way, because I think it's just good practice to monitor your words wisely, because once you get it out there, you can't take it back. So if anything, in all facets of my life, it's made me monitor my words more closely, as well as my communication skills. Always being mindful that what I'm communicating is not necessarily what that person is hearing. And that's been something I've had to evaluate not only in my professional life, but also in my personal life. So everyone in here knows who's married. Graduate school can be stressful in marriage. So a disclaimer there. I found it to be a practice of a stressful point that I had to fully aware of.
Have you felt the need to be more politically astute or politically intentional?
Yes. And there was a dynamic that came into play that was unexpected as I transitioned into this role. The future of our agency was very, very, there was a lot of unsureness. So we employed a consulting group who is consulting with us, and this is a very strong-handed consultant group. And I am I found myself being a middleman. You know, you are the leader per se in this role, but also you are a middleman because now I have people, not only the board, but I have this consulting group over top of me. And it's very politically driven because they consult with us, but they are also very aware of policy and procedure and how to pull money from resources other than the typical resources that we would use. Mm-hmm. So yes, and politics does come into play.
Mm-hmm. How is it that you find yourself making this transition? Which is to say, is this a position that you saw? Was it a position where the agency came to you? How did this occur?
This venture started probably 3 or 4 years ago, and it was there was some issues that happened that warranted the current CEO to do some strategic planning. And she was wise enough to start that early out to avoid a lot of unsureness, and also to acclimate me into that role to a degree, to be as prepared as possible. But you know, we were totally blindsided by the vast amount of changes that would occur within the shift of leadership in our agency. So this was a role, not necessarily. I always have a plan A, B, or C, as you already discussed, and this was one of those.
Was this plan A?
Yeah. And just because plan A is plan A, it doesn't mean that plan B looked better. But you can always shift plan B up to plan A in time.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
Well, we'll find out. What this transition meant for your family?
I don't really know yet, because I haven't really. What is expected of me is that you will put in a 50-hour week, 50 to 55-hour week, and you will only get 40 hours paid. Because when you are in a senior leadership role, that is what is expected and everyone does it. So I have really had to set my parameters for myself as well as the staff and the equality advocate for them. Because this consulting group is coming from the business model rather than the human services model. So it is a battle, and it will continue to be a battle. So finding a equilibrium as I transition into this is going to be difficult. It's almost as if getting graduate school done, getting that stress off, I will immediately shift into this position.
Mm-hmm.
So I will free my mind from this, and I will let
okay. Now, without getting too specific, what kind of negotiations or accommodations has your family had to make, or have you had to talk with family members about so that this is something that you'll be able to do successfully?
As you talked about tonight, there you carry with you emotionally and psychologically your family, and I try to put them always as a consideration in the life choices that I make. So considering this transition, this endeavor was mentioned, it wasn't sudden. I was able to talk with my husband in detail to see his feelings, but my husband is a very black and white kind of guy. I'm a whole lot of gray in between, so I debate, and he is very decided in his answer. So he basically told me that it was a personal decision that I must make within myself to know if I wanted to pursue that path or not. And I wanted to be a role model, of course, to my children, to get through school and to transition into this, but I did not want it to be at the sacrifice of my family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When you look at the future, do you see it as a world of certainty, a world of uncertainty? I'm going to guess you're going to tell me it's some kind of shade of gray.
I am, if you look at 100% of transitioning into my job, I am 60% concrete sure of a lot of things that will unfold, and decisions and policies and procedures. There's a 40% in there that is up in the air simply because of you think you want something, then you get into it, it may not be your cup of tea. So that's unsureness, and then you look at the world of healthcare and the human service organization. I think with healthcare it's going to be a fight, scratch, and claw continually. So that's going to be a battle. So there's a lot of unforeseeable uncertainty that I know is there, and I'll just have to continue with it.
Okay. In terms of the biggest uncertainties that are really significant, right? And I want you to think of this in terms of the challenges that you face in order to be successful in your agency and your new role, will you prioritize from the most significant uncertainties to the least the following three factors? The external environment, the agency, your board, the people whom you are directly responsible to, and your staff.
Yes, in order of concern, of course, the foremost is the uncertainty of that agency. That's the most, that's the biggest source of apprehension and concern comes. You know, the board is not super concerned, even though they do have impact. And I know the present staff that I have, and they have weathered a great storm, so I feel very confident with them and want to employ them further and encourage them further to stick with them. So it's just the uncertainty of the organization within itself.
Within itself. Mm-hmm. Now, how does that relate to the board, the environment, and the staff?
It's always, it's a cycle, it's all impactful, one upon the other. Because without the funding and the money and the necessitated need that would drive people to pay staff and for there to even be a board formulated to operate, to help assist and operate this agency. That makes sense. Mm-hmm.
Makes sense to you?
Yeah, makes sense
cool.
To me.
Right. Think about your relationship with your boss, your executive director. And then when you transition into the new role, your boss, in effect, will be your members of your board. Have you had enough experience yet as the presumptive executive director to get a sense of how the relationship you had with the person immediately above you in the past will be similar to or different than the kind of relationship that you'll have with the members of your board in your new role?
It's a liaison role between the board. And I did have enough interaction with this board ongoingly to witness the dynamics of the present board and then witness dynamics of how a board would function overall in this particular culture that we're working with. You know, this organization is. So there is also a lot of cultural factors that impact this agency as well. So to be a liaison with the board and an information source of all the information, because I report to them upon much of that agency. So I need to be a quality reporter to them in order to shed true light or quality light on them. Staff
and
their operations and their
work. Mm-hmm.
I need to be a mouthpiece for
them.
It's very scary, so I want to be a quality mouthpiece.
Okay. Now let me ask the members of the class, how many of you aspire at some point in time in your career to be a manager or administrator of an agency? Okay. All right. For those of you who just raised your hand, and as you're thinking about the challenges that you face or the uncertainties that you face, or I'll just say the fears that you might face in making that transition. Would you be comfortable in asking Christina if she's experienced anything along the lines of what your particular issue might be? Anna, you don't mind. What, we'll prompt it, right? As you're thinking about making this transition at some point in time, what do you think might be one of the bigger challenges that you'll face?
Confidence in myself.
Okay, all right. So how about if we ask Christina about that experience? What might be the, how might you phrase that question to her?
Have you had the experience doubting, you know, your skills? You're talking about moving from one position to another, one you're comfortable with, to one that's new. Mm-hmm. How have you worked through that?
I've thought a lot about human behavior, because in having a quality executive director for this. I went into work, I got out of the car, and I always knew that the bigger picture was taken care of by this lady sitting up there in the front of office. And I blindly put my faith in her because I trusted her wholeheartedly. And I dealt with the client, you know, the day-to-day activities, just the home visits, and that's where I wanted to be, and that's what I was doing. I kind of took it for granted until, you know, some time back. I thought, I want the staff to drive up in their car and shut the door and do their patient care, you know, quality of end-of-life support, and not have to worry and headache with, is the lady in the front, sitting in the front office taking care of things from a policy, political procedure, is she addressing all of that in order for me to do my job effectively and for me to have a paycheck? So the biggest, self-doubt, lots. Sometimes you are your own worst enemy, doing battle with yourself. But I've learned very quickly that the way I react, particularly when this consulting group comes in, the way I react to their information, if I look worryful or fearful, automatically it's like a ripple effect that goes around the whole office. That if she is concerned, I need to be concerned, and it just vacillates all the way around. So I'm trying to do reassurance that if there's something you need to be concerned about or warranting attention to, I will be the first to gather you all up and say, this is a concern, but this is my concern rather than your concern. If it's a group concern, we'll make it a group concern and we'll address it as a group. But self-doubt, yeah, continually, constantly, I worry, I go to bed every night and worry, can I make this transition? Can I do this? Am I going to be effectual? Am I going to fail? There is a lot of self-doubt until and the only thing that kind of diminishes that is when working with staff, they look at me and say, you can do this, and I want you to do this. So that's the only thing. And it's not that I've tried to bust myself up. If anything, someone would try to shrink away from it, and it's just not happened. So I figured then I need to transition because I've tried to shrink away from it. I can't. Self-doubt. It's there. Don't be your own worst enemy.
Other question?
And I won't make a whole lot more money. That's you. To do that. Very good. Yeah, my butt would have been sitting in the office somewhere in a chair. Not a lot more money. And it wasn't it wasn't about the money. It was simply to do the best that I could in a job that I feel very passionate about. But it helped. Money always helps. And that's something my husband and I have done a great battle over. He is a money man. He is a business model. And he's like, that's not enough money for the amount of work and stress you're going to be getting for that. You know, and he's just highly petite about that. But that's just the way we roll.
Now,
how have you been able to get a piece about the difference between what you do on a daily basis now and what you'll be doing then? Because I've wondered, if I'm, all jacked up about therapy and then one day I'm doing mostly administrative stuff, will I feel an emptiness because it's so different? Or do you
understand
the emptiness?
I understand what you're saying. I completely understand what you're saying. I have done home visit care in a home health setting. And then work cooperatively on the side to get a paycheck with a lot of other human service organizations in the area that I'm in. I think if I was coming out of this program, or if I went from the BSW to NSW and then moved straight into the administrative role, I don't feel confident. I know that I could not do that. But being acclimated and done social work for this period of time, I feel that to a degree I have done that facet of my career, my role in life. Now it's time to transition into this and we'll see what happens.
It's like a chapter thing.
It's almost like a chapter. And the issue of burnout, you need to transition sometimes because when you feel, I was happy to go on two maternity leaves for 3 months. I stayed my time. In that period of time, if there hadn't been some distance from the job, I would have been completely And I do feel like it was getting to a point that I needed that transition into something, not away. I still wanted to be, you know, involved, but I needed a different, I needed something more, probably within the agency, not something, something different, not something more, something different within the agency. But my biggest concern is I have a problem sitting behind a desk because I am used to doing home visits and being out in the field. And that is one of my biggest concerns, is how I'm going to manage an 8 to 5 in the evening day in office. I mean, any excuse in the whole wide world to go somewhere, to a meeting, anywhere outside of that office. So,
yeah. Other questions?
How do you deal with community doubt, if that makes sense?
I've not had to experience a lot of community doubt because that's been something that I've not encountered. Thank goodness, out of all the turmoil that has happened within the agency, I'm very glad there was not community doubt compounding on top of the vast amount of stressors that we have been dealing with. The agency that I'm employed with has a quality reputation within the community, but you can't always rest on your laurels because you have to keep working forward and progressing forward and making headway. So I've not had to deal with a lot of community doubt as far as the agency goes, because that's something we've not had to face. I have not had to deal with a lot of community doubt professionally or personally as I transition into, I have not encountered that thus of yet, but I'm sure that I will at some point in time. That is something that I have not. I live in a very small county where everyone knows everyone. I've been in many homes all over the county. A lot of hospice patients and families are familiar with my face, and thus far we have not marked or sold the I have not personally marked or sold the reputation of the community and this agency. So that's been, thank God, that's been one lesson we've had to deal with among all the changes that we've went through. We were at the point, and to give a little history, our census dropped, and our hospice census dropped dramatically. We also lost 5 primary care physicians in our area. We are in a county that the census, the aging census, of course, is going up, but the amount of new census coming in, the amount of children being born into our county is sick, the amount of resources is sick. So our census dropped. We were overemployed. We don't have a huge amount of staff, but we were overemployed, and this went on for a year of time. So we exhausted what we had in the bank to write people a paycheck. So we had to call in this consulting group to come and consult to see how we could not get into this shape again, how we could do better and not get into this shape again. Now it's we're booming. It's more work than what we are equipped with the staff we previously had. But amongst this, we went through an ADR review, meaning half of our patient charts were pulled, and Medicare was holding money on us for an extended period of time when we had just come from being completely in the redlining all the way. So all these people, and they weren't getting a paycheck, and they were still working with hopes. And that's a very devoted staff who comes in and who are working, and they don't know if they're going to get a paycheck. But a lot of people were greeted there. So it's been. I don't even have a word for what the agency has dealt with in the past year. That's one thing we have not had to deal with. So I said all that to say that. Thank you.
Any other questions? You can tell how well this is all planned. Hope it was instructive. Appreciate your honesty.
Thank y'all. Very much. I wish you all the greatest of success.